penso.
God had to do it himself as well.
as a sign of his commitment to the covenant. So Hebron, it's a place of holy alliances. It's a place of covenant. And tonight I really want you to check your commitment, your dedication, how you spend time with God. I understand your justification, what he did for you. But I need you to improve in your sanctification, what the Holy Spirit is doing through you. There is a call to him. We cannot deny it. Our songs are prophesied. I give myself away. Our songs are prophesied. If we miss it in the message, if we miss the message, the Lord still sings a song among his beloved. As a deer panteth for the water. Our soul, undeniably so. Pastor Juan, we are not into management or avoidance of sin in this salvation. We are just losing interest of it. My interest is dying when it comes to sin. It's never an issue of do and don't. He saved us so that we can be redeemed or delivered from our sins. He did not forgive us our sins or die for our sins for us to continue in sin. It was written because of sin. Where man is completely corrupt, but the God who was angry with us, who cast the ground and cast the serpent, but his love, through his love, he killed an animal. Right in the garden, you see justice and love at play. It is not correct theologically to think the wrath of God is removed from the gospel. It's not. We cannot have preference of one attribute to another. Yes, the Son of God absorbed the anger at Calvary, so that the punishment that was supposed to come to us was fully absorbed by the Son. That's how much God honors Calvary. So before we sit, I just want to say, the animals, as God passed through, Moses Amalari, Mudimu Fitzgeroga torch, like a torch, but only lightning, just passing as evidence. When the Hebrew people describe that episode, they call it a shabak. And a shabak is a shout. Mara, in that text, shabak is given or expressed as something described by God as to what it is. When the walls of Jericho fell, they shabaked after silence of many days, and the wall fell. All we saw, or all we heard, or as it is recorded by Joshua, is that the walls were destroyed. But exactly a shabak took place. How? This is what the Almighty did. Remember, he is not an angel, Barcelona. He does not appear and then disappear. He does not come like us and then he goes. He is already there. All that he does, he gives us an epiphany, a manifestation. For the manifestation of the Spirit. You see, we can be in this room and think God is not here. But when word of knowledge manifests, it's the manifestation. He desires to be tangible. You see, we have to transition from spiritual anointing to something tangible. Something that I can feel, that I can touch. so that we can somehow speak like John, that we have touched it, we have entered it. We know for them it was literal. That even the apostles of the land who touched him literal cannot be compared with the apostle of the spirit, Paul, who spoke and described things that they attended, that he was not present at the Lord's Supper, but he's the best descriptor of the Lord's Supper. We are people of revelation and naturals. God has put his super on our natural. In this regeneration of the spirit, we are going to see the apothecary.
Yes.
And I come to ask you, as that also these are these terms. He said, "Would you pass it on?" He's breaking the alabaster box. Your horn shall be exalted like the horn of the unicorn. And you shall be in this season anointed with fresh oil. No wonder the season that you are going to, no wonder the hell.
Come on.
King Yona Shabbat Basaba. Muti Ali Lobotimo. Abula Kota. Abula Keti. Remember the Mount of Transfiguration. Muni just will unzip. That's what he did. The body he gave to me, he just unzipped. And Peter, James, and John saw the glory. This is my beloved son. And it was that glory that they shared with him, because when he came down on him, he had to strip himself. He had to empty himself of divine privilege, not of his attributes. Indeed, he laid aside his glory without ceasing to be God. Mudimu, only a creator, I can move as a global creation. I want to take when I express at that level of humility. Paul encouraging the church, using that example, how he emptied himself, how he became poor, so that I can become rich. I want to tell you, if you understand that, nothing should break you. If you understand that that man was hanging on the cross was the most broken, most despised man. So for the people who are in that market, I will get it. From the eternal. Habula, what's that? A thing called Kairos. So now we are activated. Ultrapokromos, your time. Where you have not been seen yourself, but they have been around the walls for some time, and God said, just keep quiet. Yes. Touch anything we're going to do. Get handy. Atwa, or Raymond Latron in your hand. And then I'm going to put up. All this thing is happening even in microseconds. I don't even know whether I'm even accurate. In microseconds, he opens the portals. He goes to the animals and then he walks to fulfill his covenantal walk. He comes back, he closes the portal, he sits down as if he never moved.
Hey!
That act is called a Shabbat. Someone say Shabbat.
Shabbat.
You're the Shabbat king. An expression of worship. Man, it is the loud shout. So, Shabbat theater, when you are busy saying, I don't know if it's a joyful noise. Yes. When you are busy saying, yeah, as you shout on top of your voice, before you lose your breath, Mutimu Morikita promises, before you lose, as you go shout, before you lose your breath, I will have smashed the walls of Jericho. But I need to teach you the art of what? Of silence. Because what I'm about to do in your life is a big bang and a big shout. I'll make noise for you.
No.
Says the Lord. Oh, back the prophets. I'm dignifying them. What are the prophets of righteousness? Can I get more experience at this camp? So we both be seated and ask.
Thank you.
It's an oxymoron. Like Elijah is coming.
Thank you, Lord.
Elijah is here. Have you ever heard or been told that the people that are coming have arrived?
Thank you, Lord.
That group that is coming, that's why it does not make sense in your spirit. Because that's why we cannot just speak on the letter without engaging the spirit of the letter. The prophets of righteousness. There will be order you have never seen before. There will be a purging that we have never seen before. There will be reverential fear of him that we have never seen before. Even the worshiper will not want to draw attention to himself, because no flesh in this season will glory in his presence. It has been what the Spirit of God is doing in our hearts. It is a private, corporate revival happening in different camps. We can't own it because it is beating in our hearts. We are the right people. It comes not only because of prayer. It also comes because we are at the right time. We are well positioned. And guess what are the attributes that are going to make Gideon to make it in this army? You need it.
Thank you, Lord.
A ministry without retaliation. God is going to look for the fruit of the Spirit. And when he sees that you look like the fruit, then you are using it. Hey, Gideon. You are threshing wheat in the wine press, hidden place. You're not supposed to do that. Whatever that God is doing privately in our hearts, it's about to become a public expression. My life today, that the house of the Lord will be clean.
Amen.
And God will use whoever he wishes. What's not the way he labels in that day? I don't care who he uses. But if he can just find someone. Because sometimes there's wine, but there is no wine skin. And to prepare wine skin goes through serious metamorphosis and transition and cleansing and adjusting. The new wine destroys old wine skin. Relationship break. But that's what we do, is very much in charge. My prayer for you is to learn your prayer life. Not what you do publicly, but who you are praying. My prayer of people in the name of Zambu team, then it is a very strong in your life. Mudim, Atena, old.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Have I desired? Jesus' name. You may be seated in this place. Look at verse 40. For he that receiveth me, he that receiveth you, sorry, he that receiveth you receiveth me, and he that receiveth him that sent me. Amen. He that receiveth you receives me, Christ says, and he that receives me receives the one that sent me. Amen. Eric said this. He that receiveth a prophet in the name of the prophet, in the character of the prophet, or in his assignment. If you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you shall receive a prophetic reward. Receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, receive a prophetic reward. And he that receiveth also a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, receiveth a righteous man reward. Verse 42 shows the culture of hospitality. And what would a poor man do in receiving a prophet is just by offering a cup of water. In other words, your reception of a prophet is not determined by the gift. You can offer what you have as a poor man, but don't make a mistake of not providing hospitality and something to drink. So the verse is about hospitality. I'll explain. And whosoever shall receive a drink of one of these little ones and a cup of cold water only in the name of a disciple, imagine in the name of a student, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. Mm. What are these rewards? Contextually, it's how you said that. You'd be like, what to spend on that moment? Because I want us to prepare for a coming company of prophetic people. The verse is talking about receiving comfort in persecution. The entire chapter leading to 40, 41, 42. It carries the concept of a shalia, that's Hebrew, where a man's agent is like the man, the one that sends, where the sent one comes in the level of the sender, full representation or exact representation. Now, I want you to understand that. So he who receives, say receive. Unfortunately, this type of receive is not receiving an offering. The type of receive in this text is a dangerous kind of receiving. You can get yourself killed. In other words, I sent my servant. He, look at, think about it. Follow the verse. He who receives you receives me, and he who receives me receives the one that sends you. You see? So in other words, by receiving the one I sent, you are receiving me. So how do you receive me? You receive the messenger that I have sent, who is currently going under persecution. Things are not well with him. Receiving him into your house invites trouble in your house. So in the time of persecution, when you do, as an example, what that prostitute in Jericho did by hiding the spies, providing them with hospitality, even if you have a character that is offish according to social norms and standards. But because you have received those that are sent by Israel to spy the land, the reward of not being destroyed with the entire city because you risked your life.
Come on.
This verse is not talking about receiving. It's not like prophetic lifestyle is always a good thing. There are good times. Prophetics carry the idea of representing God, not man. So you don't bother yourself with the opinions of men. And if men have created traditions, you are already an enemy because of your standing. The more you become loyal to God, the more you become an enemy of men. So, in this scenario, you have a prophet who has caused trouble, and you are receiving him in your own house. Those that pursue him will also pursue you, should they find out. So the verse is talking about when a messenger is under persecution, and you risk yourself by providing them accommodation and hospitality, then you will receive a prophetic reward. So he who receives a prophet under persecution gives hospitality to the prophet under persecution, risking his life because of the dangers of accommodating a man who is in trouble with other men. So he who receives a prophet in the name. So this verse, I with that comfort, will receive a prophetic word. God says, if you do that, by the time the prophet leaves, you're going to get your reward. Part of the reward is what the prophet will do when he's in your house. Let's put it in our today's term. What could be the prophetic reward today? If I invite a singer to come and sing, even if I don't invite them for singing, a week will never pass until I hear their voice. It is who they are. So listen to this. He who receives a prophet, cool, who is in debt. But because we receive him in his character, he will act according to his character. So, if you receive a prophet is going to do what a prophet does. But here's the thing, these things are happening under dangerous circumstances, uncomfortable circumstances. So he who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet, you're going to benefit from his character, and the character of the prophet will manifest the office of the prophet. The man will do what? Will never leave your house without prophesying. Because the environment of persecution and the love shown in terms of hospitality are two conducive components that are creating an environment for him to breathe. He's not going to breathe in favor or because circumstances. This is not a prophet who looks for clues.
Jesus. Come on.
This is a man who is in trouble.
Come on.
So whatever he says will not fall into the ground because he is seeing you as the hand of God that has protected, provided protection.
Come on.
Right in his Moranana Adulaba cave that you have provided. If he finds you in discontent and in debt, he's going to have to speak the word. And when he speaks the word, guess what's going to follow? It's called a prophetic reward. What is a prophetic reward then? A prophetic reward is the fulfillment of the prophecy, not the prophecy. In other words, what he's going to say to you under those circumstances will become the voice of God to you. And it will surely come to pass sooner or later after his departure. You are guaranteed. He takes it to other levels. He says, not only a prophet. He says, if you receive me, if you receive a prophet, and then if you say, if you receive a righteous man. What is a righteous man's reward? If you hide a righteous man in your house and protect a righteous man sent by God in your house, what you have done, you have created a tabernacle for the messenger of the Almighty God. Now, remember the prayer of Elijah. He prayed that it should not rain. Then the Bible says, according to James 4, the prayer of a righteous man availeth God. So when the righteous man comes, he is going to come with the power of prayer into your environment. Barren environment as it is, because you risked your life to protect my servant, I'm going to open up your womb. I'm going to send rivers in your desert. So guess what? The prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And then Jesus takes it to the next level again. He says, by the way, even if you do it for a disciple, what he teaches you will become a doctrine that is going to produce the life of God in you. The little that he knows will become the blessing you require. Just protecting the right person. So what is up with this reception? It's all about learning how to discern people. Some of you have not protected a person because you kept them in your house. But by talking to them, or by encouraging them, or by protecting them, even with your words, you have done that.
No.
You have done that to the one whom God has sent, and guess what's going to happen? God says, I will reward you for it. So, for this, why Ukuruma Linda? Ubuti, the genuine is being raised as a high standard against the counterfeit. It is that time and that season where the Spirit of the Lord is raising a standard. And in the raising of this standard, we need to be sharp on discernment. And the level of the knowledge of the Word of God in your life determines the amount of discernment you carry. If you don't have the knowledge of truth, you are also poor on discernment. The more you know the truth, the more you become sharp on discernment. So So discernment in your life is determined by the word. This is important. So today, I want us to prepare for a discernment. Just to discern. Because sometimes, because of lack of discernment, we can miss God.
That's true.
Test number one. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Let's learn discernment. Let's equip each other with discernment. The government of Andrew. The Spirit of the Lord is within me. I have the mind of Christ. I hear His voice. I know that I can prophesy. Mugima Bade is about to be a prophet accurate.
Amen.
This is just a small training. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Very beloved. Very beloved. Beloved. In other words, this is our New Testament responsibility. Believe not every spirit. But try. The Greek word for try then is dikamazo. And it means to examine. It means to prove. It is not the pastor's responsibility. It is the New Testament responsibility of the beloved. If you are counted among the beloved, you are required to test every spirit. Try every spirit. Whether they be of God. Now the question would be, how do you try a spirit by what they say? You will know who they are by what they say.
Amen.
Any spirit that does not acknowledge that Jesus has come in the flesh, do you hear that? In other words, any doctrine, any teaching that does not acknowledge that Jesus is coming in the flesh, because the Gnostics in those days believed that Jesus seemed to have a body. In fact, that is an advanced course of Gnosticism, because the early stages of it were just people believing that he had no human body. They believed in the deity of the Son, but they denied the humanity of the Son. They think salvation comes through special knowledge and deep stuff. So they replace Christ, faith in Christ, with deep knowledge. And then they miss God. Okay, fine. Beloved, in the 21st century church, believe not every spirit.
Amen.
In other words, don't open up yourself to everything. Don't just absorb and take every service you shout, I receive. Believe not every word, spirit. In other words, exercise some kind of caution.
Yes.
Protect yourself from what you are hearing. But do this. Dikamas, try the spirit. Examine the spirit. You will hear what they say and then you will bring some examination. But here's the thing. If you don't know the word, you have got nothing to use to examine.
Amen.
Are we together?
Amen.
Now we're testing prophecies. So the first test that we should give to the modern day prophets is the test of the spirit. Check on me.
Amen.
As a standard. So we try every spirit. There are only three sources that are targeting your spirit in as far as divine communication is concerned. Three. One is either God is speaking to you. Two, or you are speaking to yourself. Three, or you are Satan speaking to you. Three, Satan speaking, you speaking, or God speaking. In those three things, there's no in between. It's either your prophecy is you, or the Lord, or Satan. In Acts chapter 13, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said. In Acts chapter 16, again with the spirit of divination, said, these are the servants of the Lord. So, you can speak from God, or hear from God, or hear from Satan. Okay, let me bring it into the context of one man. So let's divide him into three dimensions. The name of this man is Peter. Let's cut him into three. He's Simon. He's Peter. He's Satan in the same chapter of Mark, of Matthew chapter number 16. As Simon, he's a reed. He's saying things based on his opinions. As Peter, he says, upon this rock. He says, in fact, he says as Peter, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and the Son confirms that my Father said that not you. Peter, who identified Christ's revelation later because of a limited doctrinal standing concerning the Messiah. His eschatology says the Messiah is supposed to be a triumphant Messiah, not a suffering one.
Yeah.
That view caused him to be accurate concerning his identity, but he missed it when Jesus revealed his destiny.
Yeah.
When Jesus' identity was revealed, he now had the right to tell them about his destiny. What identity? What happened in that text? Who do men say that I am? Public opinion. Where was these things being asked contextually, historically? These things were asked in a temple in Caesarea Philippi that was created for Herod, where there was a statue for Caesar and there was a statue for Pan. Pan was the god who was believed to appear in the natural. He is the god of nature, so to speak. And then Caesar was a man who's worshipped as God. And when Christ saw the image of Caesar, of a man who worshipped as God, and saw the image of Pan, of a God who manifests as a man, and he then said, by the way, who do men say that I am? Because this is the accurate representation of who I am, not who they are. The reason why the question starts with public opinion is because publicly, those statues were already saying, we are the God-man, whereas the God-man was actually standing. So the government said, who do men say that I am? Because there was already an answer in the statues. There was no answer. Jesus says, guys, the one that I'm with, who do you say that I am? Peter, by revelation, said, you are the Christ. And one other reason why there was no answer. When the Son asked a question concerning his identity, only his true father can answer it. So there was no human father, including Joseph, even if he was around, that could have answered the question, who is the Son? And then the Lord Almighty touched the mouth of Peter. And when he touched Peter's mouth, Peter, speaking on behalf of God, said, revelation, you are the Christ. When you say to him, or when you say publicly he's the Christ, you know what happens to you? John chapter 9, 22 happens to you. The parents of Jesus did not want to acknowledge it because excommunication happens. If you are in the synagogue and you call him the Christ, they excommunicate you. But if you call him Son of the living God, they don't waste time. They pick up stones. Because to them it's blasphemy. Because if God has a son, that son is God. They don't understand the concept of the Trinity because to them it is against monotheism, the whole view that it is one God. They don't know that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, they are united in the Father, equal in the Son, and harmonious in the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
They are not three gods. It is one God existing concurrently in three distinct personalities. This truth, it is deplorable to the Muslim, offensive to the Jew. The foundation of the church is offensive. The church is the only group that says a very public statement that is that becomes the rock of offense. That statement is, all of you are wrong, we are right.
Yeah.
It is not right, it is the truth.
Yes.
Where our foundation begins, our foundation is offensive to other religions. We keep telling them it's a relationship. The greatest thing that the enemy can do against the church is to keep on biting the heel, because the Lord has already crushed the head. He's dealing with our mobility through divisions, misunderstandings, hatreds, and all those things.
Come on.
Well, stuff that you can actually repent from and be okay. Hence Christ says, upon this rock, I, not them, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. So then the church becomes offensive. The minute the revelation of the church is released, ecclesia, immediately the enemy has to build gates to defend himself. Because this is a militant house, a militant people, an aggressive people. Listen to me, they are not perfect, but they are the right ones. They are the called ones. They are the ones God will use. They are the 300 that other people will go like, what will they do? The kingdom of this world will surely become the kingdom of our Lord and Christ. They will. So Peter reveals his identity. After revealing his identity, because his theology says the Messiah can't suffer. The Messiah must be triumphant. They hated the idea that Jesus was saying, I'm leaving. Because, I mean, we left our houses and business and you are now leaving. That is why Thomas and Philip in John 14 were like, where is this heaven? Where are you going to the Father? Take us with you. They even said, show us the Father. Jesus was like, have I been with you for such a long time? And still you don't know me, Philip. When Jesus is addressing the oneness of the Trinity, that they share the glory, they share the equality. They are distinct in person, but one God. I had to say to God, it's all one, two, three. Yo, the three gods. And as careful, you can teach it in modalism, where you say God, King is the Father, the King is the Son, the King is the Holy Ghost. You know what's the problem with that? The problem with that is that the very same God who keeps on acting Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, you don't define him. And then he never shows up simultaneously as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So be careful of such examples. The issue at Trinity, in another rock of offense, mental, you know, complete understanding of it. It is a mystery of godliness, the scripture says. All writers of scripture never made any attempt to explain the Godhead, they simply declare. Just like they never made an attempt to explain the existence of God, they just said in the beginning, God. And then they will later say, if you are too much seeking knowledge, they say, a fool says in his heart, there is no God. While you are still fighting the idea, the psalmist will come sing and say, the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. And the firmament is handiwork, day after day, utter speech. In other words, the psalmist is simply saying, as I'm singing to you, how ignorant are you? Look at the sun, the stars. Who could have put them there?
Yeah.
Because nature is now telling you about the
Yes, Lord. Come on.
Yes.
Come on.
chapter eschatology ya Messiah Eric is triumphant. What's up, you know, it's a lamp and this eschatology. You remember the story when he was riding the donkey? He's supposed to ride a horse, not a donkey. So he was riding a donkey. The owner became the borrower, the God man. He who owns everything borrowed.
Come on.
Update forward, well, they make you and prepare you for Corinth. You are not going to Corinth with that doctrine. Corinth is dealing with serious divisions and issues doctrinally. You need to be first upgraded by a couple who are just members. No title. Sheba Peter. As Simon, when he prophesied, the prophet was like, he gave him more. He gave opinion. But as Peter, as he prophesies, he's accurate and he's drawing from God. But if pride kicks in, based on what you know, guess what happens? Now you want to accommodate Satan. Born, Christ will comfort him. Bona Peter. Do you want to come with the Lord and the Christ? My identity is secured. Cool. But now let me tell you about my destiny. When we get to Jerusalem, the chief rulers and the scribes, they're going to kill me. Guess what Peter did? People bought them to see what Peter went. He were our favorite powerful preacher who just said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. According to Jewish culture, if Mudise is my teacher, I'm not allowed to walk in front of him. I'm not allowed. Because I'm going to be an obstacle and I'm breaking the order of leadership and also the greater versus the less. So a disciple was required to always walk behind the teacher as a sign of honor, as a sign of respect. Peter, as the Lord was leading him, guess what happened? Who do you say that I am? The Lord is leading. You are the Christ, the Son of the Lord. As long as he's here, he's correct. But because of the limited revelation of thinking I've got it, when the Lord says, I'm going to die, Hannah, you must still deliver us from the Roman political liberator. Then. When Peter thought about it, guess what Peter did? Peter, who had the revelation, I'm talking about this reed. I'm talking about this rock. The pet. He came in front of the Lord. After he had the Lord, my man, he was right on identity. But the minute he had destiny, my man, who can even identify you? But the minute your destiny is revealed, they came on the road with you. Your destiny is offensive. Your identity. Hey! Because of that limited revelation, energy. Peter, you are not wrong. You are not wrong. You are incomplete. And because you are incomplete in your revelation, you are in the danger of being inaccurate, not false. Peter, you are not false. You are inaccurate because you are incomplete. Neisa fella gamaya. How Jesu I fella leza? Are good shot. Somebody got it right. My destiny. The church can begin now because it is built on that identity. Jesu arwe Peter. Jesu arwe to the disciples. The scribes will do this to me, and then he revealed suffering. Theology either try infant Messiah, not suffering Messiah. When Christ said, I'm actually the suffering Messiah, my destiny is to die. My destiny is to die. Peter made a mistake. He walked in front of the Lord. Now, we break the serious protocol. Guess who's teaching now? Guess who's the teacher now? Guess where the position of the Lord is now? It means Peter is a claiming a position of God, and God must take his ignorance. Because what I'm supposed to give, give revelation. You have to see what I'm man, what's not full understanding of it? He stood before the Lord. And when he stood before the Lord, he said, in fact, show me that verse 7 of the Quran. Thank you. Show me that verse. It's Matthew 16. Just show me the verse on the screen. Very bad.
Okay, show it now.
The verse 22.
It's very quick.
She's very quick here. We want to quickly go home. Mamina, the principle of the kingdom. If I can't teach you, I can't lead you. There's no argument about it. If I cannot receive from you, I cannot be led by you. From that time forward began Jesus to show unto his disciples, now he's showing how that he must go into Jerusalem and suffer, triumphant Messiah. Many things of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Peter, how you probably speak the revelation of the resurrection?
Yo!
He missed the resurrection.
Yo!
Like God, that's too big. Verse 22. Let's go to verse 22 quickly.
Yo.
Then Peter took him. He took the Lord. Ne? And began to rebuke him. He rebuked God, this guy. He rebuked himself. Concerning your destiny, concerning your identity, I'm a good guy. But concerning your destiny, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto you. In other words, this will never happen. Peter took the Lord, rebuked him. Now, look at how Christ corrects the situation. Verse 23. Let Christ correct the situation. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me. Concerning my destiny, you are not an offense. Concerning my identity, you are not an offense. You got that revelation. This thing, this one, I mean, the camps we create and the labels we put on ourselves. Apostolic, prophetic camp, camp movement of what, and this of what, and all those things, labels, Pentecostal, holiness, and all the labels we put ourselves. You know how they die? They die, they believe they start offending the Lord. Well, we keep emphasizing one revelation about ourselves. We only invite us, those who look like us. We all those things. That the minute that happens, understand this, it means prophet, reflectors. So the only thing that's going to happen, we're going to trace on each other for his identities. And so on. That movement is powerful. Even in the fathers, even as fathers. Man, none of them has a revelation of where he is going. You are good as a movement. You are great as a people. You are supposed to play your part. And would you want to come as that voice and all of that? But here's the thing. Never come to the place of pride. Never come to the place of now becoming a hindrance to the very same thing that you were given the foundation to. You laid a good foundation, but after laying a foundation, you missed it concerning where we are going. That's why God will raise Moses, kill him, put Joshua. Because we each have our place in God, and stay in your lane, stay in your place, and be faithful to what the Lord says to you. But make sure that you are in obedience and you are in the word of God. Now, look at what I meant. Get behind me, Do you know that Jesus said that it is metaphor? Anabola Satan. And the angels will do what? And get behind you. This verse, it wants a moment. The minute you miss Christ concerning a point, any important, either in his current or in relation to either the future of the church, you are now speaking from Satan. And guess what he has to do? He has to remove you from becoming a man of influence, Peter, and then tell you to take your place.
Yeah.
So, put out and get behind me, Satan. Okay. So, in other words, take me to what I want. Because he took him aside and he rebuked him. So, he rebuked him in his face. And the Lord had to now say, take your place.
Yeah.
This is where the connection is. Or where the pity will have the lady. Satan wanted to shift you. But I pray for you. So we are not standing because we are clever. God's not using you because you are the greatest or the most knowledgeable. It's just that we need to go. Puru Hedzi, like it's a why.
Yes, sir.
And you are going to meet people that are more anointed than you, more knowledgeable than you, more resourceful than you. Man, in your walk with him, miss him by misrepresenting him. Get behind me, Satan. So Peter became three things, maybe in one day. He was Simon the Reed. Our prophecies, some prophecies come from Simon. Don't take them seriously. Some prophecies come from Peter. Take them serious. But some prophecies come from Satan. Reject them. Let's stand in his presence. Ahunana, there's many things to say. But the first test, young prophet, the checker source. Ubuwa from which source? If it is not the Holy Ghost, we are not playing games. But prophet of a prophetic movement, Baba who are immature and are still growing, Baba who are fascinated with terminology and a whole lot of things, they are not lying. Others are still learning. Even prophetic schools, the purpose of those prophetic schools, no one can teach you to hear God's voice, Pastor Adam. Or is anyone being taught to hear my voice right now? You are only taught how to discern what you are hearing. Those schools, the purpose should be for discernment. Guess what? The term prophetic school cover is easy, you can easily reject it. But a prophet is an equipper. An apostle is an equipper. A teacher is an equipper. As an apostle, a prophet must equip you like a prophet. And the primary purpose of the office of the prophet is to equip believers to hear the voice of God for themselves. To discern, is it Satan? Is it God or is it me? Is it Simon, Peter or Satan? So, like a kena moye, ufila kore, touch. It or is it performance? Is it showmanship? Is it the Lord? And highly the Lord, when you come and speak, it will contribute to the order of the saviors. And it will increase the volume of the anointing, and it will be followed by testimonies and witness of believers, because you are not the only one who has the Holy Ghost after all. So Mudimu Ulukisa, the prophetic, is washing this thing. Have mercy on us.
Hallelujah. We can be seated in heaven.